So most of us were up late last night. David was in charge of coffee. Looks like David didn't bring the coffee today. So first up, I'd like to go with Lauren, a quick update on the 120 North Main Street. So the Finance Committee, you guys will be here this also. So Lauren?
So as you know, we received one response to the RFP. It's a proposal from Rural Development Inc., and it's actually a consortium of groups. It includes the Valley Community Development Corporation. The project would eventually be managed by the Franklin County Housing Authority. We also have a service provider, LifePath. The architect is local from Coleraine Austin Design, and civil engineer landscape architect is the Berkshire Design Group, who worked with us on the feasibility study. So since I was last here, the references were checked by the COG, and we conducted an interview last week with our committee and representatives of the group, and we also invited representatives from planning, zoning, historic, CPA, and conservation. I think conservation wasn't able to come. Everyone else was there, so there was an opportunity for questions. I can say for the 120 North Main Street Committee, we are very impressed with this application and feel very fortunate to have received it. This is a very difficult project. I think, as everyone knew from the beginning, the site is very constrained. We want to keep the house, which complicates the project, but is good for historic preservation. We knew that it was a very marginally financially feasible project based on the early work we did. So we feel very lucky to have gotten a very strong proposal. The committee recommends that the board accept, selectmen accept, and that was a unanimous vote. We had good coverage in the paper this week. I think it was quite accurate. The proposal is for more units than we had asked. We actually thought the property could support about 18 units, which we knew was nearly impossible to work financially. They are proposing between 32 and 34 units, depending on what they do with the house, which they have committed to preserve. And they are doing it within the footprint of the barn-like structure that we were talking about, by having a third story. So basically, same footprint, but more units. That larger building is going to allow them to create some shared service areas, which they think are very critical for elderly housing, the lounge spaces on every floor to create more sense of community, space for some social services if they're necessary, a small little kind of library meeting room. So more amenities, I think, than we had really expected from the beginning. They are hoping to for some additional funding from CPA. CPA is aware of that. That would be an application due the 23rd of February. And if CPA recommends that, that would come to town meeting ostensibly this year. Even with the CPA funds and our donation of the piece of property, we are talking about leveraging a very small percentage of a big dollar project. So I think it is really interesting for the town. I think if we are committed to having elderly affordable housing in center of town, this is our project. So I hope that you will agree with that and start to work with the group on the contract. In the meantime, the committee, having served over 2 years, pretty much we will ask member by member, but pretty much across the board would like to stay engaged as sort of a building committee through the design process. One of the members said they'd like to be there till the ribbon is cut. So, I would like to commend this committee that has really stuck with it for a complicated project for quite a long time and really wants to stay with it. So it's a nice testament to volunteerism in our town. So with that, I would just say that we, you know, recommend it, and we hope you agree, and that we can move ahead.
Mr. Bergeron?
Well, if I could, Mr. Chair, to echo Lauren's point, it was the unanimous vote of the working group to recommend to the board that we enter negotiations with RDI. Although there weren't multiple proposals, the one that we have is mirrors all of the best aspects of what the group had worked toward, what the group had gone through 11 different schemes of where things could fit and how they're sized. It's important also to bear in mind that even if we begin negotiating with RDI on the as the lead agency, there is a lot of agencies associated with this. There's a fair amount of public funding, there's some private funding, there's a lot that's still in the works. The timeline is 3 years. If everything goes like, you know, a greased skid, about 3 years, and their budget is just under like $10.4 million. So for the town to leverage up, if the town meeting votes additional $100,000 of CPA cash, specifically for the house, some renovation there, and donates the property, we will have a total impact of a total cash outlay of about $365,000 total for nearly $11 million of housing that we will not manage, which is something that we're very clear about, and with a group, a consortium that builds these projects and with our own housing authority managing it. You can't go wrong with it. So I would say the questions that were at the meeting in this room last Wednesday or Thursday, I think it was Thursday, were probing, and the group was well represented, and the answers were we want to work with you. They were excited about having continued participation, and it seems like it's the right time, and we have the right team in place.
Thank you, Scott. Dave, any questions?
No, I've been following it.
Finance committee?
It's good.
Would some of the residents get a
priority? There's a lottery system, mm-hmm. and they would have some priority.
Right.
It's actually spelled out in their legal guidelines, so to the extent that it's legal,
right.
Residents will have priority, and then I think eventually there are two pools as things turn over. So they know that that is something that we wanted, and they are going to do that to the extent it is, legally allowed.
And what's the age limit? Will there be an age and an income guideline?
There are income guidelines. They're still working on, there's like 60%, 70%, 80%, 100% of an income level, and they are right now at some of the lower levels. And I think most of those discussions, what I have learned from this process is, a lot of those considerations really have to do with how they're going to get funding to build this thing. So they are trying to leverage everything to get funding so that they can put this package together. So there are questions about, exactly what those guidelines, what the best mix of
so the funding is dependent upon whether it's a higher or lower income level,
how much funding.
Exactly right. And so it's a percentage, 60, 70, or 80% of the income from the prior census. And so with us, 60% of Sunderland's income level, 70%, 80% allocated throughout the building helps them apply for, using the different formulas, helps them apply for state and federal funding. But it's important to bear in mind those numbers during our feasibility study were pretty interesting, a family of two is like $56,000 a year. It becomes eligible.
Yeah.
And you were talking about cash, not assets. That's, cash flow, not assets. That's very important to bear in mind.
So assets are not included?
Not included.
We should verify some of that stuff with them again, because a lot of that was information we got from our first round consultants, now we're dealing with a lot of people.
Right. There is a good point. They should validate it, but I suspect the same formula.
I think they understand what our goals are, and I think they're basically trying to do the best they can and get enough funding to be able to make it go.
I just know one thing. The last time we were even close to having something was back at our 275th anniversary. Now we're getting almost to the 300th, so it's been 25 years since we, right, since we really had anything close to happening.
I gotta say, you know, if you even compare those two projects, some of the things that have changed is these units, other than perhaps the one especially upstairs in the existing house, you know, are accessible. There's an elevator in that building. You know, there were things that weren't even really required for, you know, this
well,
is
over
much,
there was no elevator. It's amazing. We can remember stuff from 25 years ago, but it was a two-story building, and there was no elevator to get to the second store.
I think in terms of one of the things that came out of the meeting the other day is that the population of people in elderly housing is getting older, and more people want to age in place, and some of the amenities and some of the considerations in even the planning of the building are to, you know, hope to help that happen. So I think it's reflective of where we are in our times. I think it's a very strong project, from what we want to do.
Lauren and I had talked earlier on the way up about having another meeting before town, you know, having a public information before the town meeting, so we get more, probably at that time we'll have more specifics, so we'll probably be looking at that as well, so.
What would the total height of the building be? Is that a conceptual thing, or?
What they told us, I don't know what it is measured by, but basically we had looked at, in the feasibility study, we were looking at something kind of barn-like, two stories with a, you know, sloped roof, and all they are proposing is dormers in the roof and
the third floor
level within that kind of roof level.
Yeah.
So I think the way they have portrayed it is they have not really changed the massing of the building.
So it'd be comparable to like the old town hall over there? I mean, maybe the height of the building?
I think it would be shorter than that. Yeah, shorter than that. Yeah.
Your first level is going to be a ground level.
Right.
So there's no.
Yeah, it's not raised up like that is.
You know, I think honestly, I feel like one of the things that we will work on, or one of my interests moving forward, is basically how that building sits on a piece of land and how we sort of have the gentlest touch that we can, considering where it's located. But
did they still include the pickleball courts?
The pickleball was out, but there were some areas for community gardens and a little patio, planting trees. I mean, it's very considerate of the neighbors. I think it's basically what we were hoping for. I mean, it's.
Scott, do we need to?
Yeah, actually, I would make a motion, Mr. Chair, if I could, that we accept the recommendation of the 120 North Main Street Working Group and begin negotiations with RDI on the development, design and development of the 120 North Main property.
Good. David?
Second.
I have a motion made second. Any further discussion? No. So basically, we could hold these open session?
No, these are all absolutely open session. Because
it won't be detrimental, because there's no, right?
Not at all. And as well as the reminder of the fact that the town meeting has given the board the authority for disposition. So I think I would recommend we stay in open session at all times.
Perfect. You got the motion there, Sherry?
I do.
All right. So we have a motion made to enter and negotiate to accept the 120 North Main Street recommendation to enter into negotiation. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We are going to be negotiating. Perfect.
See how easy that was?
Look at that.
Thank you, Lauren. Next up is we have a chief of police from the town of Sunderland who does not negotiate.
Actually, we are in the middle of negotiations, not with him, but with the department.
Yeah.
Chief, have you met the finance committee?
Not the entire board. Some people.
Guy, could you introduce yourselves, please?
My name is Sean Randall. I'm the chair of the committee. Nice to meet you. I'm on 81 South Lane Road.
Dan Murphy, secretary, 180 North Main Street.
Bruce Bennett, you know me.
Dave Powers, 18, South Main.
Alex Cascaro, 7 Muscle Street.
Blake Crowe, I live on the side, 248, my parents.
I feel like I know you, I've seen you on TV. Kind of watched you from the past, so thank you for having me.
Chief, you've been in, what, about 6 months now?
About that, yes.
All right, so we have the, before us, the first budget. You want to run through it, Chief?
Sure thing. I'm assuming you've run the copies already.
You guys all set?
Yeah.
Okay.
If you didn't get a chance to see my interview with the selectmen, I never shut up, so please at any time jump in and tell me. I promise not to make this too long. I too was up until crack of dawn watching the Patriots.
Yeah.
But it's I actually watched the second half of the game today after the win. Oh, it was amazing. It's amazing what you missed the first time through.
That's true. I'll do that tonight when I get home. Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay, so when looking at the budget request, we have it broken down into different line items. Police chief wages, officer wages, full-time, police department overtime, part-time wages, clerk wages, and department expenses. So by contract, the police chief wages was already agreed upon, and that's actually not going up because it's staying the same as this fiscal year. The allocated amount, anyways. The full-time officer wages, I do show a 1.4% increase. That is, I initially put in the words per contract because I was including the increases for the full-time officers, but was instructed to remove that because that comes later. You guys do that differently than I'm used to. So the $3,000 increase really is only, and I had to go through and break down the budget, not knowing exactly how the money's spent other than the obvious. Officer, 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 and then I didn't know where court or how much money was spent sending an officer to court, trainings to extra coverages, just to make sure of those things. So to go across the board and see where, if any, I have to go up, just to complete the schedule, that was only a $3,000 increase on that line. The major increase that you see two lines down is the part-time officer wages. The reason for that was that I was hoping to include two more or three more part-time officers. We currently enjoy 6 part-time. From what I've seen in the past, the town has had in double digits, 10, 11. Part-timers are great. You can utilize them. You're not paying them overtime unless, of course, they're working more than 40 hours a week. You can utilize them for different shifts where the full-timers are bound by contractual obligations. So if there's anything over 40 hours, they get overtime. If they work more than 8 hours in a day, they get overtime, things of that nature. The part-time increase also reflects not just adding a couple of officers on, but also the ability to train them. With the MPTC, the Municipal Police Training Committee, they're requiring the full-time officers to get 40 hours in service, so it's like continuing education with the teachers. The part-timers also have to go through in-service every year. That includes first responder, CPR, defensive tactics, legal updates, because the law never stays the same, it's always changing. And every officer that we have, from the top all the way down, has to attend these trainings every year. If they don't succeed in filling these 40-hour requirements, they're going to no longer be a police officer. They lose their certifications. And it's not just about going to the gun range and shooting a couple of rounds to some paper, and then you're good for another year as a police officer. It's that plus the first responder, the CPR, legal updates, and things of that nature. So keeping that in mind with the impactful addition of getting a couple of part-timers on, that's where the increase comes out of for the $7,159. The other small increase of $500, which is tied into the $7,159 and the, oh, I'm sorry, tied into the first one, the $3,125, it was a $500 window where, according to the full-time union, they have a shift differential, so evening shifts and overnights. We didn't actually, or I couldn't find where every shift was accounted for. Yes, second shift and overnights were accounted for, but the swing shifts, we have usually two, sometimes three shifts a week where we have a second officer on, from say 7 p.m. to about 3 a.m. So from 7 p. to 11 p., there's a second shift differential, and from 11 p. to 3 a., there's a third shift differential. This didn't account for that, so that's why that was also tied in. And the expense line, that was based on contract increases. So when I broke that down, our simple cell phone communications air cards, we have air cards that go on the laptops or the iPads in the cruiser, so you can run license plates, run warrants, things of that nature. That stayed the same, but we added a cell phone. That would be mine. It doesn't come out of the selectman's budget, it comes out of my budget, so that wasn't accounted for, so that yearly bill was added. That's why that went up. $624. Also, a meals slash travel line. It's the travel reimbursement based on a contract that was assigned. And the clothing allowance never articulated or never encompassed any clothing for me. I'm not expecting a large amount like the officers do, but this was a brand new uniform this morning. And this is probably one of the busiest days I've had running around, and I look like a bag of rags. I got dirt on me, and so it's amazing how bad that gets.
We were going to talk to him about his appearance.
Yeah, apparently.
It just totally fall apart here, Chief.
Totally. I should have bought a second change of clothes for that. So that being said, the additional request for the expenses was $7,600. So altogether, it was a 4.2% increase. Not including any union negotiations for payroll or any other extras they may get on. And that's my quick version of it. Be happy to answer any questions you may have about budgetary.
If I could, Mr. Chair.
Sure.
We are, as the Chief knows, we're meeting every other week with the association and hope to bring a finalized contract, 3-year contract, prior to town meeting. So there will certainly be changes on the officers' wages. We're in the year 3 right now. So we have a work in place. If we don't get to town meeting, it can carry through at current levels, but I suspect we'll have a new contract. Okay?
Okay. Alex?
So just to clarify, everything other than the part-time fixed wages will be essentially level service and just getting the budget to match reality. Like the full-time officer wages, for example, that's just an increase in pay, not an increase in hours?
Yeah, there's no increase in hours. This is just to follow along with how I broke the budget down, not having a budget from before to work off of. It was just, here's your payroll number and here's your expenses number. I had to go through and figure out what do we spend on the employees, that much we know, and I took that part out. And then I had what was spent on overtime. Okay, well, here we have 15,000, I believe it was 15,000 set aside for overtime. So I took that out and then slowly went through and see where did we spend money on officers attending court, there were summons to court, different trainings, the state mandated ones, or any trainings where they went to be, an instructor or something. Getting all those taken out, that's when I had to start putting things into different, fall into different categories. And no matter how much I try to move things around, it was always falling short from another line. So that's why it's based on how many hours were worked, not anyone getting any pay increases, because that's going to be part of the contract negotiation. This was based on if I took from one line to go to another line, it was still something, was a deficit somewhere. So there was no way to, and I don't know, come to find out later on, they ended up getting a $5,000 reserve fund transfer, not a reserve fund, inter-department transfer. They took out of, I believe, supplies, or maybe it was out of salary supplies. Because the chief left and you had his salary left over, so that remaining money went into feed where they had gone over. And that's where we figured out, that's where the problem was. So trying to get that to at least a zero line, so where we go across the board, later on, we can say, okay, everything is paid for. Another thing that came up was the amount of calls for service. Just dispatch itself showed about a 500 something increase in calls. So it went from, like, say, 1,400 calls for service to 1,900 and change. So it increased about 500 calls. I can break that down to explain what exactly went up, if it was officer initiated, if it was resident or extra motor vehicles, because I'll tell you, that's the one thing I noticed when I came here. You have a lot of car accidents. It's because you have a lot of cars coming through town. So I don't know if more people are calling things in or residents are calling things in, but the calls for service had increased about 500 calls. And we're already slated to match that or to continue over that for this year. Hmm. And we're only 5-6 weeks in. Where we are now is where this department was probably in May for arrests and calls. So we are a couple of months ahead, and we have an officer out. He is at the academy. And I can tell you from experience, when they get out of the full-time academy, they're full of energy and want to go find something. So we'll have to see how that, the call volume there fluctuates. But already we're at an increased level of calls, and we're only a month in.
Bill Gray is sticking on Main Street with the radar.
Trust me, I did it for Halloween. I'll put him there again. So.
Well, actually, Chief, one of the comments that we had received when Sergeant Lyons was the acting chief was many people in town were very appreciative of the extra attention that was paid to speed in various roads in town. So that was a very positive thing. And not paid attention, but also how the officers handled that. And I think that it was treated as a learning experience versus, I thought that was good also.
Great, that's wonderful. Hopefully I answered your question. I didn't mean my voice.
That's a pretty substantial increase in calls. 500.
Yeah, I was actually floored by that. 2015 was 1,400 and something, and 2016 was 1,900. And that's only the calls really that we're calling in. One of the things that I found, and it's not here, it's this county and this area, a lot of the officers don't call in the motor vehicle stops. I only came from Central Mass. I've never heard of that. Well, I did hear of that. It's called the 1970s. Why are we still doing that? Given what's out there today, I mean, everyone else that we deal with on a 90% basis, 95% basis, no issue. But it's that 1-5% that's going to be that issue, and I'm not going to know any different until it's too late. So I, unfortunately, but I haven't heard any complaints from dispatch. When I stop a car, I call it in. It's just something that I'm used to doing, and I've already started to tell my officers, you know, I would rather you call stops in. And they reminded me, well, it was all just during the day shift. You can get hurt just as easily on the day shift as you can at 2 a.m. Usually it's more repetitive on 2 a.m. because, as my father used to tell me, nothing good ever happens after midnight. He was right. But big increase.
So, Chief, can you explain a little, now that you've been here for a while, explain your philosophy on when you talk about full-time, part-time officers, it was interesting because we've gone through a couple scenarios where one chief wanted less part-time, that way he could give them more hours, and because they give them more hours, they'd probably stay around longer. Sure. Then we had another, other chiefs that wanted more part-time officers because figured that you'd try to spread it out so you'll always find somebody available for the shifts. And also use part-time officers versus full-time officers to fill out the watch. Have you had a chance to look at that yet?
I've been looking through what we've done in the past. Speaking from experience, the past 10 years as chief, and then coming here, I can see the pros and cons for both. But my personal belief is, given the size of the communities that we have, I came from a 5,000 population town. I get to enjoy a smaller population here. I see the need for a part-time contingent. Unless we want to go full-time officers across the board, having part-timers is going to assist our full-time officers. Taking time off, if we have investigations, if we have the need to place manpower officers around town for some reason, paying them at a lower rate, they may not like it, but that's why they come on part-time. I enjoy having the part-time officers because we can rely on their dedication, their energy, and the fact that it's not going to break the bank. So understanding where we stand with our budgets, it's too early to dismiss a part-time contingent.
Bush?
The calls for services is very interesting, and I think it would be worth the effort to see why there's such an increase.
Most definitely.
You know, whether it's self-initiative with the officers or whatever, and also the times that those calls for services are coming in. Does it help you deploy your manpower?
Yeah.
And the cell phone is owned by the town?
Yes, this is the department, town cell phone.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's why I have two. This is my personal one, this is the department one.
I noticed that you rolled the fuel expense into the department expense. We have two different line items for those, and we track them differently based on the fuel expense of the public safety complex.
In the police department expenses, it was explained to me that under police department expenses, part of that budget, $12,500.
Right, yeah. Yeah, and it's a different accounting code. I don't know if we still want to keep that, right? Yeah, so we probably need to break that back out again.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, they showed me that we still had 12.5 in the fuel, and it came out of that line.
And 25 in the department expenses, right? For a total of 37.5, which you showed.
37.5. So yeah, whatever the split out was.
So 12.5 and 17, right?
The the police department expense last year was 25,000, and the fuel is 12.5. So it's two different codes, 5,400 and 5,420.
5,420
was it? Yeah, that's the one. Yeah. I think that's right, Sean, because we always kept fuel on the side, separate out of the expenses.
Yeah, we did because of the
volatility of it.
Mm-hmm.
Because it would be easier to add energy contingency to that line item.
Correct.
If we knew it was being used for gas.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's great, because then we get to increase, or we have to subtract from the budget, we can say, well, that can be, let's go after the other side instead of fuel side. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Right. We have in the town general line item, we have an energy contingency fund. And we kind of separated out fuel because remember 4 or 5 years ago when the gas prices were going crazy, that was one of the things that we did so that if we had unusual expenses, we could use our energy contingency to help pay for that.
Oh, outstanding. Okay. That was not explained to me, so I apologize.
No worries.
David, Bruce?
While we're on the subject of fuel, the highway department put in a request for fuel pump being fixed.
Okay.
What's your feeling on having the own fuel versus buying it someplace else or whatever?
Well, it's a catch-22. I think we need to have both, or the option of both. We had it in the town I used to work for. It was great until it went down. And then when it down, we had nowhere to buy fuel. So having a system or a backup to purchasing fuel if the system goes down will be great to have. The problem with that is you have to find a company that is not going to take you to the bank. A couple of the companies that I dealt with in the past will try to charge you $8 to $16 per car, whether you used it or not. Okay, but after a year, it's $100-something or $240 for the use of cars that I've never used. And I thought that was ridiculous. We shouldn't be doing that. I've been told that there are some companies out there that do not do that to municipalities, so having that as an option would be great. Now, that being said, towns usually can get in at a municipal rate for fuel. When you're buying bulk, you're buying a bunch of fuel at once. You may get a discount. You know, usually, I think they take tax off, or is that part of the something that they, whether they take tax off or they give you a lower rate or both. If the town has, say, a fuel account, and you know, we use the card and go through, they know that car, that goes to that department, you know, for later on, but it's out of that account, it can't get paid out, then one. But I think it saves the town some money if you have a fuel, the main account for everybody, but having a backup is huge, because if we don't have a generator, or if we don't have, say there wasn't a delivery, we have no fuel for the weekend, telling the officers to sit in the station is a waste of taxpayer money. Sit in the station, don't drive, don't start the car.
Yeah. Right.
Great. Now everyone's running around town, flying, and breaking into houses, and you might be able to respond. And I think we need a backup for that. I mean, you need a contingency plan for everything. So.
Could that be set up with like Deerfield? Do they have their own fuel as a backup? I mean, it's not that far away.
We have done Deerfield. That before. Yes.
They must have their own fuel.
In fact, when we had the bid was very high compared to what we could buy locally. So we did work with one of those surrounding stations that they were able to go over and fill up. So yeah, we have done that. But it's interesting. It's back 3 years ago, we had the October storms. A lot of the gas stations were not open. And a lot of the surrounding communities were coming to us to get fuel because we had our fuel tanks, plus we had the emergency generators, so they could come and actually use it. So, yeah, Chief, you're absolutely right. That's what we see also. But it would give us, if we had something set up, it would give us the flexibility in case prices go, if we buy high, we could, you know, theoretically get a better price. And it has happened in the past. So.
From what I've seen so far, this past year's numbers as far as fuel came down considerably from the previous year. That's great, especially when you have a budget and you know what you can go on. It's when it goes the other way, it's a real kicker. So we lucked out on this one, but you know, I've seen it go up and down.
Another question for the chief on the budget, David?
No, he answered. My question was about the call volume, so.
Okay. Finance. You want to review the some of your capital expenditures, Chief?
I would love to. This guy came in and he's like, "Hey, I just need money."
Yeah.
And you're all sitting here going, "Oh, what are you doing?" So I submitted the capital expenses, and I did submit four of them. I put them in order of need. So the first one that I submitted was for a replacement cruiser. This would replace one of the existing Ford Crown Vics. It's a 2008, the one that's marked up with the really dark tint on the windows. That's the 9-year-old car. This car would replace that.
Take, Chief?
Yes.
Is there any reason why we tint the window so heavily?
I don't know. I mean, I know canines tint the back windows for the dog. I personally believe that a cruiser's back window should have some tints, especially if you're transporting a victim or a juvenile. You don't want to go through victimizing.
But not the entire car.
No, I mean, that car seems to have really, I don't think it's over the limit. I haven't really put the meter on it yet, only because I don't want to know. But there's an exemption for police cruisers.
It's interesting, Chief.
Like, I'll have to drive back to the station tonight with the windows open. I'm not used to that. I have it out back if you want to see it. I'd have to drive back for the windows open.
Can we see it at night?
Yeah.
I can tell you what probably my philosophy is. I always thought, do you want to make our police should be approachable? We shouldn't have people afraid to, and I think when the cruiser goes down the street and somebody waves at the officer, you know, there's a exchange and it's okay to see faces and stuff. That's been in direct opposition to some of the past chiefs, so.
Unless you see me coming at you, you have no idea if I'm waving at you.
That's why I always had a problem. We used to have black cruisers, and we got that changed to black and white, being, you know, that was, what, 3 or 4 years ago.
Everybody knows what they are.
And we hadn't worked through the whole tenting thing yet, but if possible, I would strongly suggest being careful with the tenting.
Sure, I understand.
I think that's not conductive to good community policing.
Sure.
Thanks, Chief.
No, no problem. So the first one shows a replacement cruiser. So this one, the current 2008 Ford Crown Vic, when it was new, would get you 17 miles per gallon. It's probably pushing about 13 or 14. That's the V8 cruiser. It's also, this car is you may have seen it, I think Deerfield has one, and the Deerfield Towns has one. It's the SUV version of the Ford that they have. It's not the Explorer, but it's the all-wheel drive version. It's great on gas mileage, it's all-wheel drive. It's not like the Tahoe. The Tahoe that we have, there's a purpose for that. You know, there's gonna be times where we have to drive in areas where you need a tank like that. This is an all-purpose vehicle. You can drive, and the gas mileage is going to be amazing compared to this 9-year-old car. So that cost is everything included. I think you have, you might have a quote, basically setting up the paint job, the lights, transferring of equipment, a radar unit, what's one thing that we're lacking severely in at least two of the cars. The radar units are quite old. We do get them certified every year. Just by looking at the one that's in this car is probably the second oldest. You guys bought a car in last year, 2 years ago, that Ford Interceptor?
2 years.
Yeah. The radar unit that's in that car, wow. I remember those when I first started. Kudos to you for holding on there for 20 years, but it's time to retire it. That thing is oxy and huge, and when you turn it on, you can literally hear it winding up. I'm surprised it hasn't just busted on you. But anyways, so a radar unit. They don't come cheap. Those themselves are $2,000. So that's where that increase goes in. So a cage, and it includes the set up for a mount for the laptop or the toughbook. It's kind of like an iPad, but a police purpose one. The system that we use is called IMC. They don't run off of iPads. So we're paying for an air card for the officers to run plates on the state system, but we have a perfectly good system sitting there we can't use in-house records on, or we can't enter information into it or check our own database. It kind of limits the officers. So that's, you know, we're paying $39 a month for the air card, and all it's doing is giving the officer the ability to check if there's a driver's license and if they have warrants. All valid things that we need to do as officers, but if we need to check an in-house record to see if there's any stay-away orders or harassment prevention orders, things that may or may not show up on the person's criminal history. So that's included in there. And then the Opticom switching. Opticom is the switching that goes in the light bar. So when you get to an intersection, it automatically sends a pulse. The fire trucks have them. I found it interesting that one mounted in a cruiser is only $200 more expensive than one that they give you that you put on your dash. And then you have to manually shut off and turn on. Which is crazy. If I get broadsided, that thing's gonna come flying off and hit me in the face. So I'd rather have one in the light bar so there's no extra wires. But it also depends if it's LED or strobe. We priced it at the LED because that's what I was assuming it at. And I'm still, the fire chief's checking his fire truck to see if it's LED as well. So we'll get that answer. So that's the first and foremost. That's the one that was the most important to us.
How much?
Oh, I'm sorry, so I thought you had that. 47
221.
That's everything.
Okay.
That's SUV, package, everything.
47 221.
Oh, yeah, look at the other part.
You think you can get them throw the cup holders in for nothing? So you're looking for 40 bucks for a couple of those?
They should, right?
No, it's 40 bucks for a couple of those. Maybe we can go up to 40 bucks.
Yeah.
Maybe we can take them out of the car.
A couple of those.
Is that two MHQ?
That's two MHQ.
And they take the old one?
It must be pretty good.
They will give us $500 for the old one. Now, if you don't want to do that, then we don't need it fully. We can bring it back down and we can do an auction again. It's got well over 100,000 miles. It's up to you guys. If you can get more than 500, I say take it and do the auction. Just do it before 2 years and let it sit for 2 years.
Right.
Do that the other time. The next one, the number two, is evidence room monitoring. We've got a beautiful public safety building. I'm very happy that you guys have this, this building I get to enjoy every day. So thank you very much for everyone that was involved. The only problem with the evidence room is it's under lock and key, multiple doors, yes, but there's no alarm system within it. There have been police departments that have experienced issues where outside people have gained entry to it, and now they have a new cache of weapons and drugs and cash. And there's also other departments that have dealt with their own internal problems where that's gone to. This cost is only $2,150. This is our number two for the projects. It's a very important need. It needs to take place. We received some quotes, the one that came in at the lowest one was a company that we looked at. I think we received three of them. And the cost associated with setting in, the alarm panel and everything else, and it was all set up on here. So like I said, $2,150, and that's the exterior panel where they can arm it and disarm it, and there's motion sensors and everything else that's needed to notify most likely either dispatch or an on-call person. I would believe it would be dispatch, and then they would dispatch the officers back to their station and say, hey, you have an alarm going off at the station.
Does that have cameras with it?
That does not, but the station has cameras, which leads me into number three.
Even outside cameras?
We have outside cameras at the station.
How many active criminal cases have now that are requiring you to store evidence?
We have to store evidence for, in some cases, a very lengthy time. One of the things that Sergeant Lyons did after me being here for the first month, he began to do a quick audit of the evidence room. If you haven't opened a computer or turned the TV on, then you didn't know, but there's been some departments that have been plagued with some evidentiary issues across the Commonwealth.
Many
departments. So we did our first quick audit, see what we have, to make sure that they match with what we have in the computer system, and then determine what can be removed, destroyed, thrown away, and what needs to be gone through with the state police. Because if you want to destroy the drugs that we have in there, there's a process you have to go through. Unfortunately, the firearms are an issue. If the firearms are not tied into a criminal case and we can get those to a bonded warehouse, there's a few in the state that do this, that's easier. But those that are involved in a criminal case, we can't do that. We have to store them until we can either get them to a dealer with the owner's consent or their help, because the evidence depends on the length of the case. So luckily, we didn't have too many cases. The evidence room is not busting at the seams. They were able to go through and figure out what was in there that could be destroyed. Cases that were old, that had no bearing on somebody being brought into trial again. So those were easy enough to remove. The drugs and the guns obviously had to stay until we can get confirmation with the state police. And then once we get that with the state, the drugs can be destroyed. That being said, we probably are at 50% capacity with that room. It's a small room. It's at the closet. We have shelves, and it's getting there.
How many active criminal cases?
The active criminal cases. I honestly do not know.
Okay.
I can look into that if that's something you guys require, but I can tell you from experience, probably all of 2015, or most of 2015, and a few of 2014. To include the couple that we've had in 2016, yes.
And would this alarm be for just the locker area?
Just that evidence room, yes. It'll be a panel that we can disarm it, go in, access, you know, enter the evidence, close it, lock it, and then we lock the panel. That panel should be locked 24/7 unless we're going in to either put something in there or retrieve it to bring it to the lab.
Will this system log who comes in, who goes in and out?
Most systems allow you to set up multiple passwords, passcodes. So if somebody unlocks it, we can go in and we can contact the vendor, and then they can tell us, you know, passcode 9876 was the one that used it, and they can tell us, okay, this is who was assigned to that code. So each officer, and it's not going to be the entire department, it's going to be most likely the sergeant, an assistant to him, and then maybe to include me. So in case I have to go in during the day to remove stuff to bring to the lab. But for the most part, probably two officers and that's it. So that way it's not, everyone's got their hands in it. We have, in our booking room, we have a series of lockers next to where the officers work. That's what the officers have access to. They open it, they put the evidence in, they close it, they push the lock, and that's it. It's up to the evidence officer to take it from that locker and then bring it, enter it, make sure it's entered in the computer, and then bring it into the evidence room. So there's only two, maybe three people that have connection with that bin to the evidence room, and then from the evidence room to either court or the labs for processing. The officers themselves don't have access to the evidence room. It's just the lockers.
So everything is locked down currently.
Yeah.
So the alarm is only in the case that there's nobody in the building?
No. If we were able to get this, the alarm system would protect the contents of the room from everyone. Those who are not allowed access. So I could have a police officer in my department that is not authorized to have access. If he or she has a key and then gets in, they would set off the alarm. They're not allowed to have access. They can't disable that alarm. So it's not just keeping the outside world out, it's keeping whoever's not authorized to get into that. So the panel should be armed at all times, unless the evidence officer or somebody going in, and like I said, it's probably gonna be two, maybe three people, they're gonna go into that room, grab whatever evidence is going to the courthouse, so then they can then give it to the officer that's going to court, and then log that, or they're gonna take that, like I went to the crime lab Monday, last week. I was able to go in, I have a key to get in, take it, log it in the computer, lock the door, but there was no panel to rearm.
It's just the difference between trying to protect just to the next level, or between somebody who can swipe a key to somebody who can swipe a code.
Yeah, basically. But also think of it this way, you pay taxes for an officer to go out and be on patrol. They shouldn't be sitting in the station waiting for the next call. We want them to be out being seen, being at different events, doing radar, whatever the case is. So that station is empty. Somebody is not there, sitting there, unless they're typing reports and they're gonna go back out, but that station's empty. So if somebody wanted to, you know, they see an officer go down the street and say, now's my chance, and they try to break into the station, what do we have to deter them? We have nothing.
Oh, it's
locked. Show your house. You know, there's so many different vantage points of getting in, unfortunately. I'm not gonna name departments, but between here and Central Mass, there have been departments that had their evidence rooms broken into. And items stolen, guns stolen, drugs stolen. I don't want us to be that. I don't wanna be in the news for something like that. I'd rather us have something secure, the alarm goes off, we respond and catch that person or begin the investigation. It's never happened. And I hope that it never happens, but we need to have something, and for that much money, I don't think it's a major cost. We need to have something to protect us as a department and protect us as a town.
So your concerns are back to being a mix of outside and inside?
It's a mix, yeah.
And it looks like you got a $96 quarterly charge there for the monitoring, is that?
Yes, that was...
For the ongoing costs?
Yeah, that's going to be the ongoing cost. It's going to show... they send you a bill every says it in here. It's quarterly. So we'll get a bill and then we process that out. That's basically for the alarm handling.
Right, the monitoring of it.
System. The alarm goes through, the alarm company gets it. They then go down the list, whether it's they call dispatch or they call one of us. It's probably better if they call dispatch because there's somebody there 24/7. I wouldn't want the alarm going directly to dispatch because they're busy answering 911 calls for the entire county. I don't want them seeing an alarm come through, nor do I think that they would allow it. But an alarm monitoring system is if you say you have an alarm for your house, the alarm comes in, it goes to the alarm monitoring system, that company then calls dispatch, they then get us on the radio. Same thing, except it's our own system. If there's a fire alarm in the building, same thing. The fire alarm goes off, alarm monitoring, it notifies dispatch, they turn off the fire.
So is this company, monitoring company, is the same company that the fire department uses, Deerfield Police? Is it a sort of a police sort of monitoring system? Because
it's a private company.
It's a private company, yeah.
But we had a meeting last week about library and they had a lot of issues with the monitoring company.
Right. Well, I was actually going to piggyback on if I could about monitoring. This contract proposal, the way it reads, I mean, it looks like they're going to be picking up the fire alarm monitoring at the same time. Right? They want to use the existing notifier panel.
You can use the panel because it's already there.
I understand.
The notifier is already there. So I think they're the ones who do the fire alarm system now.
Right. So if that's the case, then they'd just be piggybacking up another monitoring piece. Okay.
Out of the three that we got, like I said, this was the lowest bidder.
Yeah. And monitoring's been, to your point, Sean, monitoring's been a challenge in a whole host of our municipal buildings.
Any other questions, Scott?
No.
Chief, can I go back to the car for 1 second?
Oh, yes.
Radio on the car. I heard something about the Franklin County radio maybe swapping over to 800 megahertz versus the present. Have you heard anything about that?
I've heard those rumblings, but I haven't heard a 100% this is how we're going. I know there have been departments that have had issues with receiving and transmitting. Luckily, we haven't had too much of an issue. There are some dead spots in town. On Portable, on Cruiser, I don't think we found any. But some of the more western county, when you head out towards Buckland, they're having some issues. So the radio system is based on a repeated system. And when you start throwing on more antennas, all you're doing is fogging the system. When you have a voter system, or if you have towers that will receive that voter system, you know, if I'm calling you on the radio and you don't hear me, but dispatch hears me, well, that's fine, as long as dispatch, because you're not going to be able to get me the two counties worth of help, but you can.
Right.
So then you can then relay it. And that's a lot of the issues that they're having. There's multiple towers throughout the county. One of the things that they looked at doing was start looking into a state police type setup. It's 800 band. State police does it. New Grantry Dispatch does it for their 10 towns. And then from what I can tell, it works great for them. The only problem is the equipment costs a lot of money. Mm-hmm. You know, we have portables at the station now that can cost between $500 to $800. This portable here can cost between $900 to $1,300, depending on if you get the attachments and the different things built in. You guys didn't buy this, so don't worry about it. You come out of your budget. And then the state police radios. You've got the APX, you know, 5,000, 6,000, 7,000, whatever the bandwidths are. You can do UHF, you can do 800 band, like a truncated digital system with the state police. Those are great, but you're paying $6,000, $7,000, $8,000 for a portable radio.
Yeah, that was one of my concerns, is that if you go to the 800 megahertz, not so much concerned about Sunderland per se, because we're basically flat for the most part, but the 800 megahertz I think would have a hard time penetrating into like apartments or densely dense structures.
There have been issues when you're inside of a school, let's say Frontier Regional High School. I know, speaking from experience from Central Mass, the regional high school there, unless you were in near a skylights or an outside window, you get a lot of feedback, you weren't being heard. 400 band is what we operate on. Great with punching through buildings, but with the terrain that we have, not so great. So that's why you need those towers set up in a way so that it can receive and then transmit back to dispatch.
All right, so they haven't said anything to you about thinking about replacing your radio equipment?
They did a study asking how much equipment do we have, how much could we get by with, things of that nature. If that's related to, we're changing, then so be it. But no one's actually officially said, we are definitely going over to 800 band. Yeah.
No, I was just wondering if you had included those costs in the car also, in the cruiser.
No, the cruiser cost, all that is just transferring what we have in one car.
Okay, so you're going to stay with your same comms. All right. Yeah, I was just interested. I said again, I thought there's a big difference between 800, the cost of an 800 megahertz versus 400.
Yep. Oh, definitely.
I mean, it's like between the difference between buying a Chevy or a Alfa Romeo. It's big dollars.
Yeah.
Bruce?
So look at the license plate readers on the cruiser.
Sure. $17,900 for one car. And that was a quote I got 2 years ago. So
how much is that?
Down.
Yeah.
$17,900 for one car. I'm sure it's gone down. Oh, it's amazing. Well, the great thing about a license plate reader is it takes away any perception of profile. All the computer does is take a picture of the plate, runs it, and tells the officer. The officer's just driving down to go get his subway, to come up here to drop off payroll. Doesn't matter. It goes, boop, you have a suspended license, you have a warrant, you have this. The officer's not looking, the officer's not making that conscious decision. Am I going to run this one, but not run this one? And run this one? No, the computer runs everything. You drive through an apartment complex of 400 cars, it runs them all. Faster than I would, And the great thing, it comes back and it shows you the picture of the plate in the back of the car or the front of the car. And you look and go, oh, okay. And back up and go, yep, there's the car. There's the guy, there's the girl, or whatever it is. It takes away the concept of profile. That's great if you have the money.
Are there ongoing data costs with that too, aside from the unit cost?
No, most cell companies, the only two companies that I've seen that works with the registry is Verizon and I believe it was Sprint.
Yeah.
I don't think Sprint works out here that well. Verizon works so better.
Yeah.
No other company has processed the registry to change it, so they can do, like, say, AT&T or T-Mobile or Boost. It's either Verizon or Sprint. Those are the only two options. Unless you have a satellite system within the towers, so say you have this consortium of towers, and you do packets through the MDT,
yep,
and go off the bandwidth. That works. But you'd have to have a decent satellite tower.
Yeah, network.
But to get your point about the data,
you got an extra money?
Come with unlimited.
Okay.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. They stuck to the trunk and in the front, and then it's nice to have, but 2 years ago it was $17,900. I'm sure they've gone down. Nothing goes up in technology, right?
Okay. Any questions? Questions about
those two?
Yeah. On to number three.
What you got next, Chief?
So number three, and again, like I said, the first two are the most important to us. Not to detract from the next two, but I'm sure I'm getting the glazed over look. But number three is the capital improvement request for the actual public safety complex regarding the video system and the key fob, door entry and camera access.
Look, did you skip one? The opticon switching?
That's number four.
Oh, okay. Just a different order in the book, that's all. Okay.
I can do that one first, because it's less of a hit. No, okay. So this one is the public safety complex. To redo the camera system, the digital recording device that comes with it, and then the door access panels. So what we don't have right now is we don't have an automatic lock on the door, the front door. So manually the officer comes in, sometimes myself, sometimes a midnight officer, locks it or unlocks it in the morning and then locks it again. This is just one thing that this would do. It would automatically unlock it by itself and unlock it by itself. Holidays, it would stay locked, or however we programmed it. The interior doors from the lobby, there's two doors in the lobby and then two doors in the back, the main hall that comes out with the conference room is. Each one of those doors access, two over here access the fire side, two over here access the police side. And then you have the exterior door in the very back, and I believe another personnel door by the bay for the fire department. This would give a, they call it key fob system. Key fob, and I took one of the ones that we have sitting there, so I could show you tonight. Little disc, HID, a lot of security companies have them. You can program multiple codes, different zones onto these. You can assign an employee to one. So if I assign this to myself, every time I used it, it would come up saying that the chief used it. 2 a.m., 2 p.m., Saturdays, Tuesdays, it would show on the system. And then if we had them assigned to the cruisers, so if I had this, say, assigned to me, but I left my keys at home, and I had a fob for the cruiser, then it would show that car one or car two was being used. That you can change the access to multiple different settings to, like I said, weekends, holidays, different time zones. It's a little bit different than, say, if you wanted to assign somebody a key to get into the building. Because unless you have those little keys with the inside cut, you can take it up to leaders and, or whoever makes keys around here, and then make you a key. And then you come back and say, here's my key back. And then you have a key to our building. Not to say that people do that, that type of mindset, but we run the risk of doing that. We do that with all the employees, police, fire, and then have some set aside for the public, because I know they use the conference room. It would replace the current video system. We have a camera system in every jail cell. A camera and a microphone in every jail cell. The booking room, the interview room, and then exterior, we have one, two, three or four. We definitely have three right now. The total cost for that, thank you all for being sitting down when I tell you this, is $21,671. That's a huge pill to swallow. But what's the matter with the system now? The key fob system does not work at all. I have some background in it, so I've been tinkering with it for the past 2 weeks. I finally have the two systems on, and they're talking to each other, and I found the software, and I've got the software to talk to the boards that run the doors. I can't program the doors to do what I want them to do, and I can't. I finally was able to program one card, and it can only be used once a day on each door. So it's been taking some time. It was put in when the building was built 11 years ago.
Did it ever work?
They say it did. It hasn't been turned on. When I got to it, the power cables were ripped out and the access panels going to half of the building and the fire alarm system were ripped out. So I was able to, put them back in and get a bunch of alarms. We bought little watch batteries because they were the backups to the door batteries. So we got it back up. So we're doing some testing on it. But in the past, I'm not a licensed person to do this. I've only gone as far as I can go. The next step is to get somebody in here. I'm not going to do that because that costs us money. So I'm going to wait to see where we go from here. If we can get the doors to work, we get the system to work, great. But again, it's an 11-year-old system. The cameras, great to have the cameras. The ones in the booking room and the interview room and the jail cells, wonderful. The rest of the cameras, some of them are black and white, some of them are cloudy, some of them are not focused, some of them are really bad. I've gone through and tried to see if I can manually zoom. The only one I was able to fix on that was the one in the cruiser bay where they bring the prisoners out and bring them into the booking room. That was able to tweak a little bit, but that's on its last leg. So we're going to either have to start replacing them individually or look at a system that will replace all of them.
Why is this one separate from the evidence room?
Because I figured that this would probably get shot down, and I really wanted the evidence room.
Okay.
And I wanted the evidence room to be counted before this was even thought of or drawn.
So like in an ideal world, we could probably say somebody
all
getting off
the yes. Yeah.
You can get a quote to tie both in. Just, I mean, I think it makes more sense to something like this. In my view, is important.
Yeah.
Politics is one. You can tie both
all the inside.
Together,
yeah. All the inside.
If you would just sell the town that because if you want to be in a situation where you have to come up and say, I wish I had.
Definitely. I would love to do that and tie them both together. We initially were trying to get a grant for the town. So we were involved with the town in getting different views of the different buildings. That's where we got all these quotes. I didn't take it upon myself to say, well, I'm going to ask the town for a bunch of money, so I'm just going to start asking for vendors. Thankfully, the town got grant money for a different building. So that was great. We got that taken care of. And I felt, well, we already have the quotes. I'll bring it forward and see if that's something that we're able to do. But if you had asked, if you asked me right now which one, if I had to pick two, obviously the first two, this is definitely a need. I think we definitely need this. Given the system that we have now, you know, they've been operating the systems for the past couple of years the way it hasn't worked. We can get probably by, but and I know I'm not selling it any more than I should be, but to fix the entire complex, this is something that we have to do. Now, we can apply for a grant next year, and if you deny this, then that's something that obviously we're going to keep pushing for, but like I said, when the chance comes up, to take it.
So, for instance, so this is a lot of this, I mean, some of it, like the cameras in your cells and whatever, that seems very specific. But a lot of this, the doors would also be on the fire
side,
right?
Yeah, because that's where it's existing now.
Have you guys talked to the fire chief about that? Do we want to split the cost, or is it like building the police side?
It's
a facility cost, really.
It's for the entire building. It's not police specific. This would be going to the public safety building to get the building done. Then. Part of this would also include getting enough key fobs for the firefighters. So when the firefighters came, they get toned out, they come up, they've got the key fob, they go beep, door unlocks, they open it, they go in, they hit the overhead doors, they get in the bus and the trucks, and they get ready to go.
Yeah, okay.
Same thing for the police side. The police officers would be coming in with the prisoner or coming in to work, and they use their key fob to enter the building. And then we'd have a running tally. Whereas right now, the only way, I have no way of knowing if a police officer is in the building unless I sit behind the camera and I watch the camera before and after the shift, because right now they're using a key. If they lose that key or someone steals their keys, on a key fob system, I can disable it and trace it. So when it comes up, it flags the system and I can go back to the cameras or if I'm there, it sends an alarm. With a key, I have no idea.
Those are just RFID tags, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and honestly, if we were to get HID tags in this building or any other buildings, you can link them together. So if, say, the town administrator has a key for this building, we could then set her up to have a key for the public safety building and the library, if you do any other buildings. So you have multiple or different systems, but all the system wants to know is what's the... what's the facility code this comes from? What's the card number? And then what access do you want to give them?
Yeah, those are getting pretty cheap, the RFID systems.
Yeah, these aren't that expensive. And these are a little bit more maneuverable than the square ID tags. Those snap and they break and kind of cumbersome. These are easy.
You're thinking about splitting the capital cost though, between fire and police. Is that where you were kind of going with that? Rather than dumping it all into one department.
Was to possibly talk about blending the splitting costs between fire and police.
Makes sense, I mean, because it's a shared facility. Right, it's not a departmental cost in that sense.
And the fire chief was aware that I didn't put in for it. I don't think I told him the cost, but I told him I didn't put in for it.
Plus, I think we're not eligible for the upcoming year, but we could get, because we got an IT grant in the last round, but we might be able to slide this in under the IT grant, maybe. The following year, yeah, depending on, because we got that for our phones the last go-round, but it could be an option for that, too.
The last one is, well, the first one I talked about was the cruiser, and that was to include all the costs. This one is to just a standalone off-the-comp switch. So we have times, it's the red light, green light emitter in the light bar. This would get put into one of the existing cars that we have, whereas this cruiser purchase was getting put in when it was being built. This would be added to one of the existing cars. This is a portable. This one we can leave in the equipment room, so when we do have two officers on duty, they can grab it, they can put it in the car that they're using, as long as it's not the new one, as long as we get the new one. They too will have that ability.
So none of the cruisers have these in them now?
No, not one.
So even if you get a new cruiser, you still want this? As a backup for the second?
Additionally, the answer is yeah. Mm-hmm. Second setup for a second car.
Second car. So, I mean, and here's the thing. We're not going to be using that new car every shift. So there's going to be times where sometimes you're going to have to go through the intersection without it. And how do you do that? Well, like you've been doing for the past how many years? Stop and look. Just because you have blue lights on and a siren going doesn't mean people are going to see you when you're going to coast right through it. So it's to slowly get us to having an entire fleet with them.
How many lights do we have that actually have that in there? We've got the intersection over here, right?
Well, the main 160 and the 47 one.
Is there another one?
I don't believe it's on the one at Squire Village.
Yeah, okay.
But there are other towns going towards out of town have them as well. I know it's a huge cost for one intersection, but I'm assuming that the other intersections are going to be getting them, especially with the amount of traffic we have. But again, that's why that's my last one. It's at the bottom. It's the bottom of the barrel because the other ones ahead of it.
Well, I think it's safety for two ways. Worst thing can happen is T-bone somebody. Probably worst accident you can have, and that's what you would have at an intersection. So, to me, it's safety of officers and safety of the public.
Yeah, it makes sense putting them in the cars as you get new cars too. But
that's the thing.
That's the way to do it. Right.
Good. Any questions? Any more questions for the chief? Francis.
Okay. First, move for the select board and sheriff. You know, we have the police now and the library, and what is coming up? These systems that monitor fire, you know, all this stuff that detects. Is there a room we can tie and build the school too?
Yep, time together.
We've been pushing for that for a long time. Yeah, that's one of the things we're trying to do is to share the costs of things like that. Yep.
Supposed to all this piecemeal.
Yep.
And no offense against anybody. It's just I'm wondering, is there some way we can start working on this, tie all these systems together so we get some cost savings from it?
Mm-hmm. That's something we've been pushing for a while to do.
And what are you pushing at this moment?
The other groups that we would share it with, like the school departments and things like that, because you want to share your costs wherever you can, and we would try it with copy machines, all sorts of stuff, and especially like IT equipment. That would be a perfect way to push costs.
So what I would say,
Francis, is now that the chief has his. Looking for that, the evidence room is DetectoGuard, which is new, which we haven't used before. DetectoGuard, we just started using DetectoGuard here, in this building. That's who the library is. Now it's a good time to start talking about, see if there's any, if we can combine everything to try to get savings by having three or four places together. So you're absolutely right. Mm-hmm. That's one of the things that we can try to do now. Before, everybody was kind of. There was like little, we were on Sentry or
Guardian,
something.
I think it
Guardian.
Was.
We had Guardian, somebody else had somebody, you know, the library had somebody else. So now we're just kind of finally we're starting to standardize, Francis, so you're absolutely right. So hopefully we're going to try to, Sherry will try to work with the library, the police, and our building to see if we can try to put some savings to that.
I guess my hope is, if this push about green regional is to work, I mean, towns like us have to start to need to work within us for sure.
Absolutely. Agree.
We agree 100%.
Yeah. Agreed, Francis. No, I agree. Any other questions for Chief? We'll probably have to talk some more, Chief, later down.
Sounds good. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, Chief. Next up, Marlene from the South County Senior Center.
Yes.
Just let you know, Marlene, you're probably going to run into a hostile group up here since in the paper you were quoted you were going to support anybody but the Patriots. Now,
I'm just saying, let's just,
a Steelers fan.
Now, if I know that, I would have said,
I think we got to be careful when we talk to the newspapers.
I'm a Yankee fan.
You know, he kind of twists things at Andrew.
That reporter, doesn't he? Just remember, Marlene.
And there he is. Did you see his picture? He's with Sharon Kachuk and who else? Nancy and, I think a few of our seniors are writing as they're talking.
Just remember, they buy their ink by the gallon and the print by the ton. So
it was a good article.
Marlene, you want to introduce yourself to the Finance Committee?
Yes. Hi, I'm Marlene. I'm the South County Senior Center Director for the town of Waitley, Sunderland, and Deerfield.
So, Marlene, you missed earlier in our meeting. It looks like we have very good news about our potential senior housing. So I know that's been a topic of conversation over at the senior center.
Yes.
Housing.
Yeah.
Okay.
If you have senior housing, you are more eligible for more grants to rehab and purchase some senior centers. The state grants and federal grants like that to know that you have a town that has, you know, senior housing, and which right now is, I think this would be the first one in our area. I don't know if Waitley has any senior housing. I know Deerfield doesn't at this point. Low income senior housing, there's a difference between 55 plus, which is, you know, non senior housing versus low income senior housing.
Marlene, you want to just describe some of the things that go on at the senior center?
Sure. We offer congregate meals through Life Path Incorporated. It used to be Franklin County Healthcare Center in Turner's. So we have our congregate meals, and we are the Meals on Wheels site as well. So LifePath brings the meals in, and they get distributed. They pick up their bags and stuff of that nature. And then we have meals served on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays from 12 to 1. A hot meal, which consists of the protein, the grains, vegetables. They're good meals. Our seniors like it. We have a lot of participation. We have at least about 20 to 30 seniors sign up for lunches those days that we are open.
Is there a charge for those?
It's a donation. It's a $2.50 donation. They don't ask for it, but if a senior wants to put in the $2.50, they're more than welcome, and it's anonymous, so they have a box where you can just go up at the end of the the day or before and just put it in. You know, you don't have to sign anything, so no one knows that you did donate or didn't.
How much do the costs are covered by the donations?
That would be in the lane. She's our dietary manager. I'm not really, because I'm not privy to how much they do collect. I have no idea. I just know how many meals that they serve and stuff. And that money gets counted at the end on Friday, every day, and then it gets deposited with the bank, you know, their bank and stuff that they do.
Is that included in the gifts line here?
Pardon?
Is that money included in the gifts line here?
No, that would not be, that has nothing to do with us. That's for the congregant meals. That we don't, that gift here, that is a gift fund that we have that has not been put into the budget for so many years because it should not be offsetting. Yes.
So the meals fund is separately, completely separate than this budget here. That's something else that.
That's for like half, that's Meals on Wheels. That has nothing to do.
Different agency.
With us.
Different agency.
Different agency. They just, we serve meals like most COAs. All the, a lot of COAs. Either if you have your own dietary, you have your own cook, or a lot of the small ones here come in and stuff. You know, we all use the services of like, which used to be Franklin County Home Care. For our meals, let's see. So we do our congregant meals. We have educational programs, medical, educational, have people like from Walgreens, Rite Aid, CVS, that come in and talk to our seniors about, you know, different prices, Medicare, you know, Medicaid, that sort of stuff. We just recently had from Franklin County Sheriff's Department, the DA came down and did a presentation about assisted livings and living wills to give that information for our seniors. So we offer those kind of programs. We offer exercise programs that we get a lot of grants from, and just recreational events of that nature, and entertainment.
Some of the programs that they offer, they're offering yoga. There are different types of yoga.
Oh, yeah, yeah, we have the exercise
programs. They do Tai Chi.
Yeah. Osteo in the balance class. We received grants, state grants for a balance and motion class for a 12-week program where we had an instructor come and she would put in her main voice up, and it would be about an hour. And so that will be finishing up. But we do have a yoga class, and we do have we do not have the Tai Chi anymore because we don't have that grant. They went to another grant, Church Street grant, instead of the, it's still a Tai Chi grant, but it's not the Tai Chi grant. And so we still have that, and then we have our osteo class. And other programs that we offer quite a bit. You know, come up and visit, you know, for a newsletter. Let's see, and I'm just trying to go off the top of my head.
They have classes, they have painting classes, they're going through painting.
Yeah, we have a watercolor. Yeah, I was going to get them when we do the grants, but we have from the cultural councils from Waverly, Sunderland, and Deerfield, we received grants to have a, we have a watercolor class, an eight-week watercolor class, and now we also have a sewing class. So some of the seniors really like that, reminiscing and sewing. Right now they're making a quilt that they will raffle off. And that donation will go here. So that's pretty much the things that we do have going on. Entertainment, we have our annual barbecue, which this year we have Jimmy Maz He's real popular, you may not know him, but all seniors know him. And he's very, very popular, so that's one of our big events, and we share that with the Triad, Franklin County Triad Services.
And you also had mystery dinners?
Yeah, the murder mystery, we just had that. That was a cultural grant from the three towns. That was interesting, but this time we're going to just have the annual. Well, we have a ukulele teacher too. She's going to be teaching ukulele for a few weeks, which should be quite interesting. And
4th of July picnics?
Well, that's our annual.
Right, yeah.
That's the annual.
And you have, usually have the Triad, the spaghetti dinner. Would you guys participate with the Triad to
yes,
help Triad?
Yes, we do, yeah.
So one
we're
of
the... We're also having the sock hop. You really want to get into
it? Yeah, I have I forgot about the sock hop, yeah.
We're having a sock hop with the Ray of Elvis in April. I don't know if you've ever seen the Ray of Elvis. He's very good, too, and the seniors will love him. I will, we all like him.
How old do you have to be to take advantage of these benefits?
60 years
older. 60?
Are you 60 yet,
though? Not yet,
you
Bruce.
You know everything about him.
I'm on the board of directors, Bruce. Trust me, Bruce. Just one of the other little duties that we have, right, Marlene?
Yes.
We have meetings with Marlene all the time.
Yes.
Well, probably not enough, but.
Not enough. I wish they were like once a month. It would be nice.
I would say the senior center is one of our. The budgeting, just so you know, the budgeting for the senior center, we agreed 6-7 years ago. Deerfield pays 50%, Sunderland pays 25%, and Whiteley pays 25%. So the people, the town that they come from, it's maybe not exactly that split 50-25-25. Sometimes there's more from Sunderland, less from Whiteley, or more from Whiteley, less than Sunderland. But we figured that was a pretty comparable number to shoot for. I think over the years we've had, Marlene's our third director, I think. Hmm. Again, we've had very good directors, and Marlene just continues that. And the directors have all brought they're all put their thumbprint on it, and some of the programs. I mean, like, they have we. You still do the we, right? Or not so much now?
Not so much. We do not really have the clientele who really are interested in that. Our clientele has changed. You know, the agent in place, whether they don't come anymore or they ended up in the nursing homes.
Yeah.
And a lot of our seniors go to Florida. So right now we have, you know, we're like missing 15 of our seniors who are away, whether in Arizona or Florida. So when they come back in the summer, they don't want to really be inside.
Right.
So, you know, we sit outside. We ended up, we had a flower bed, a vegetable garden, and Conway had an article that, I think it was Conway, I don't want to say, because I can't remember exactly which, senior center, but there was a nice article in the Recorder that the Home Depot in Greenfield built them a raised flower bed. Raised.
Way
about
up.
This
yeah.
big, long, with these seats. So as the director, some of the seniors brought it to my attention, and they said, you know, Marlon, we really like gardening. We can't really bend down. And so I called the Home Depot and plug them here, the Home Depot in Greenfield, and I said, you know, this is so and so, we saw your article, could you come down, would you be interested in doing that for the South County Senior Center? And they said, sure. They came down, and a month later they came back and I said, yeah, we'll go do something. So they took all day, and this thing is better than the other. We can sit. I mean, it's like a bed. I mean, it's like so.
If the seniors want, can they go grow their own marijuana there now?
No.
But there are very interesting things that they do. I mean, Marlene's very still taping your show. FCAT comes over. They use FCAT
yes,
used to come over.
Yes, when we have our Name That Tune, FCAT will come over like they did our They were invited for the annual picnic. We are hoping that they will come. Plus, we would like to get Channel 22, because this Ray of Elvis guy is popular everywhere. So 22 follows him, Channel 40 follows him. We're hoping that if we get him, they will follow and come. So we're hoping that Jimmy Maz is really popular. He plays at the Big E every year, and he brings a big crowd. So we're kind of, you know, happy that we've got some big names. I'm sure they'll be watching.
So it's all, you know, so there are many things going on. At the hardest part that we have from Sunderland is getting transportation. And we have been, and we're working on that. Sherry's represents us on the PBTA governing board. So we're trying to work more in tune with Franklin, because Deerfield is part of FRTA, the Franklin Regional Transit Authority. So the PBTA and the FRTA are two separate entities. So the transportation between the two places is a little difficult.
FRTA has demand response. I also understand that the PBTA also does have demand response, but we do work mostly with the FRTA that will go get seniors. And we have like five of them now. By the transportation. I mean, it would be really nice to have our own van and our van driver. I should have added that somehow. But then there's all this liability stuff and everything. And, most of our seniors drive, so that's really not much of a need.
Well, if they can get to Forest,
they can get to Yes, it's far.
I noticed the bottom line is the budget's not increasing anything from over last year.
Actually, it is, but that part is for the total expended. We haven't expended anything yet from that. We haven't done that part. I guess that's not what you're talking about.
So it says 2018.
Yes.
The expense for Sunderland is the same as last year.
Oh yes, it is.
So it's still the same.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. But actually, I was just going to what I did do with my maintenance and facilities. I ended up getting a thermostat that's programmable. It works really well. It goes on at a certain time and it goes off, and it's programmable, so we're not spending heat uselessly when we close. So it goes off probably by 5, and it comes back on at 7. I mean, not 7. Yeah, 6 or 7, I think it is. So that works for us, and we turn off the lights, other equipment that we don't use. So our gas, electricity, janitorial, we changed our landscaping to a more reasonable landscaper in snow removal. It gives us a deal, because he starts from the library and he goes all the way down with that big machine, all the way down to the bank. Yeah. So he does that whole street, which helps us because we have that street on the front entrance, and he does the side and does salting and stuff. So we decreased those. So I could increase our newsletter, staff mileage reimbursement, equipment, miscellaneous programs costs, for like different supplies and stuff that we need. Some of the seniors are interested in, they've seen it on TV, that exercise program or country western music. Oh geez, it's probably on Home Shopping Network or something like this. One day and watch it, and they're like, oh Marlene, it's only like $45, $49.99. I think we could get that, and that would be kind of, some of our seniors wanted to do that. So that kind of stuff, where we have just a little program expenses and trips. When we go on trips, it's always nice to have some extra cash, just in case if some of the seniors aren't able to put in for the gas or the electricity at that time. And we do not receive our Title III grant, that changed. We do receive our our state grant, our service incentive grant, which is for our outreach coordinator. We hired an outreach coordinator on that $15. Right, yeah, we hired one. And if you notice, it has expenditures. I decreased that to give more salary for that. This grant is, you have expenditures, you have your expenses for this grant, and you have the salary. And when you do the grant, you can do it where you can give more for a salary, because then you're able to find better help, because you can increase their hours and you can increase their pay, and less for expenses, because a lot of times, you know, they're using our printer, you know, and if they want something in the newsletter, we put it in the newsletter. So, you know, we kind of took away some of that expense and put it more for salary. And our formula grant that we just did was an increase from last year by $4,542. So that money we would be getting in for each town, the formula grant, which offsets, which includes, that helps with program costs, that helps with how we run our departments, it helps with salaries. So there's a lot of documentation in that. Our common meal services, our educational programs that we provide, law items and stuff. So, and it's really, it did increase a little down here, but not too bad.
Any additional questions for Marlene?
Yes.
What's the scope of your membership or usage? Like, what? Like, how many
does this
annually, I guess, would you say?
Yeah. Oh, let's see. How many seniors? We have, probably, don't quote me on this, probably between 300, 342, 350 seniors who are members of the senior center, who are active members of the senior center. We have, and we have other, we have more seniors, if we count it all down, probably up to like 600, 700, 800, but they're not actively participating. They've signed up, they joined, but don't come anymore, or came that one time. So pretty much actively, it's about 300 to 500 seniors. On an average, and this is an average, we have, I divided it for five days a week, because we do have some programs on Tuesdays. We'll have movies, cribbage tournament, and Thursdays the yoga is happening, and we go on trips. And those days we try to keep it open as well. We average about 20 to 25 seniors for a 5-day, but if we get a 3-day, we're up more. We're almost like 35, 40 seniors on, you know, those 3 days. So we're very active, and most of the seniors are regulars. You know, you can really count on Monday, we know who's going to be there, and on Wednesdays.
Well, these yes. Are all three towns or just one?
It's all three towns. It's for the town of Wheaton, yep, all of them.
So you don't know what number of persons come from Sunderland?
I can get that for you. I would have to just look it up and break it down of how many participate. I did that with our annual report, how many new seniors from each town. But I can get that information to you. It will take me a little bit.
I'm asking because I would like to know how many seniors here in town are not using the program and why they are not.
Well, that's why we have our outreach coordinator right now. We have a system, it's called My Senior Center, which it's a an IT program, it's a database program that a lot of CLAs use it. And what happens is the senior will sign up, you know, you'll have a sign-up date, you get a card. What we're finding and what the outreach coordinator and myself are doing is that this senior may have signed up in 2011 and signed in twice, but we haven't seen them. So what her and I are trying to do is to go through that database to see how we can find those seniors. Once we put that database together, we can say who comes to the senior center, who doesn't come to the senior center, why don't you come. I did like a rough draft when I first arrived here. Mostly our seniors have either moved, aged in place, they have passed away, can't come to the senior center. Actually, I just called recently, maybe last week, I haven't seen a senior in about 3 or 4 months, and they said that the senior went to a nursing home. So we would never have known that if we didn't, you know, pick up the phone and call, and we don't hear that. So we need to go through that database, but if you need numbers of how many seniors do attend from lately, how many seniors do attend from Sunderland and Deerfield, I can have that within a few days.
Just something, this is a pie in the sky dream for me. If we have seniors like somebody who was coming to the program and then goes to a nursing home, do we have any way to reach out to them just to show that we care?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, presently, right, we will, Sue Corey, our program coordinator, she does our programming. She handles sending thank you notes for recent donations. She also sends, if we hear that someone is in a nursing home, she will, and if they received our newsletter to their home, she will get the address and send it to them at the nursing home. We'll have cards signed to get well. I visit a senior who's at a local hospital where I live in West Springfield. I see him twice a week. Right after I get out of work, I'll go down and visit him and, you know, bring cards or candy or something until he can come back to, you know, they can come back to the senior center. So we do make an effort to go. Once we find out, we do make an effort. And if someone has passed away, we do make an effort to send a sympathy card to the family members.
One of the problems that we have, Francis, is that, believe it or not, a lot of the seniors are very isolated from one another. Mm-hmm. And there's not a lot of, unfortunately, there's not a lot of communication that goes on. That was one of the reasons that we've gotten the grant for this outreach coordinator.
Yeah.
And I think we hired her, maybe 2 months ago, a month and a
yeah.
half ago.
Yeah.
So she's only been on a very short time, and I think she has 15 hours a week.
Right.
She's for 15 hours a week to do exactly what you're saying, to try to go out and we're actually trying to. Marlene's been very good at working with like the Sunderland Library, and the Whiteley Library and Deerfield, and finding different ways to communicate with the people that may use a senior center, or they may. I would say non-traditional uses of the senior center.
And our outreach coordinator has just put a letter together for professional services. Hmm. We have contact with Franklin County Sheriff's Triad Department and the Triad and the DA, but there are other facilities too, like Bay State and Franklin County, and you know. They're social workers, so she has a social worker background, so that's kind of an asset because there's like a lot of marketing and she knows people. So to get that out to the professional, we work with the town nurse in Deerfield, Dr. Colby, the foot doctor. If he sees anything or he notices that he hasn't seen anyone, and you know, they will contact us. So we do hear, it's just that we have seniors that signed up in 2011 and they only signed in twice and we haven't seen them since. And there hasn't been anyone actively keeping that my senior center database updated. Sue is, because she worked by herself a few times, that, you know, she's finally getting it, we're accurate with our birthdays, you know, so we know when the seniors' birthdays are. But it's going to take time, you know, to get it all up to date. And with the outreach, once we have it updated, then the outreach coordinator can reach out to these people, call them, find out, send them a letter. Why haven't you been, you know, to the senior center? You know, do you need transportation? And a lot of people do call us to say, you know, this person needs transportation. Can you help them? So.
I'm getting young people involved, like talking about high school kids from Frontier.
Yes, and we have had, we had two young ladies from Frontier last year. They had a program that they needed to get some hours. One of them was able to set up a Facebook page to reach our seniors. Another way to reach our seniors is because a lot of seniors do use the computer. A lot of seniors are on Facebook. So we have our own page that now you can like. It's South County Senior Center, like our page. So they've been doing that. She did that, and now we have another one who's need hours, another young lady, I think she's a junior. She needs hours, so she's going to be working 15 hours a week, helping with the fundraiser for Meals on Wheels. She will help with some reorganizing of some of the senior center, updating the Facebook page, and different stuff of that nature, and working with our program coordinator.
Yep. Francis, you know what the biggest problem with a senior center is? Most people today don't consider themselves to be seniors.
Yeah.
Huh. Trust me, I know.
And but, well, they don't consider themselves seniors, and they think about the old time senior centers where you just played bingo and maybe cribbage or pitch. Mm-hmm. They don't understand about all the new things that are offered in senior centers. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because we've talked about renaming or rebranding the senior center, but a lot of people aren't for the rebranding. They like being called the senior center, and in particular, the state likes that also.
Yeah, and oh yeah, of course. And I think the thing is our senior center, and listening a lot of through the grapevine, so to speak, a lot of the seniors say that our senior center is the most homiest, it's the nicest. It may be small and compact, but we all know each other. It's friendly, it's user friendly. Some of the new buildings, you know, are just like, I'm not gonna say any senior centers in particular, but some of them, you know, it's big and, you know, they don't have a lot of participation. You know, we have a lot of participation. You know, we receive donations all the time. On Fridays, we have our farm stand Friday. We receive produce from Atlas Farms, and all the kids in the area, the schools, are always doing a can drive for us, for our seniors.
Tom's question, are you getting your old people, like if people are aging out and moving out?
I think what it is, we have our regulars, like I said, who come on a regular basis. There are other seniors, younger seniors, probably here Wednesday, but there's two types of seniors. There are seniors who participate in other programming, because that's what they have always done. And then we have the other set of seniors who volunteer. So we have a lot of those seniors who volunteer. And I have gotten them to sign in when they volunteer, because it's a good idea, because that increases our numbers. And we have to be accountable for grants. And stuff, I can say, well, yeah, you know, this is how many people we have coming to the senior center. And even if they're just there to volunteer to help out with a fuel assistance application, we have quite a few of them. Our yoga instructor, she volunteers, you know, she's really nice, and they just pay every 8 weeks, you know, $15 or so.
They do taxes over there too.
Oh, yes, we have a big tax group coming next month for our seniors, and we already have a sign up list for that, and that's on a volunteer basis too. So, yeah, so those are the two types of seniors that we do have, the ones who participate and the ones who volunteer. And then there's that third one who thinks that they're not seniors.
They're still using the same services, but like at the library.
Yes. And again, library has different services than us. I know Kristen does different things based on when we're closed. So because some of our seniors who participate our place really like participating at the, you know, at this library or Whately Library. So we all kind of work together to, you know, provide different programming.
Any more questions for Marlene? Comments?
If I could, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Bush?
I just want to thank you for reinforcing my faith in humanity.
That's nice.
Well, you know, it's a dog-eat-dog world, and I wish there was a whole lot more people who are sharing stories like that.
Yeah, I think one of the things, I come from West Springfield, which I love dearly, run differently. You know, with the mayor and stuff, some things about that issue, but that's another meeting with the mayor. But anyway, I like West Springfield. What I find since coming here is that I'm welcomed. It's a home. I mean, it really makes me, you know, get choked up because it's like everyone cares about everyone. Everyone likes to talk about this and this and that and everything else. We try to keep it low key, especially with all the politics and everything happening. But everyone is nice, you know, everyone just works together. I have a wonderful program coordinator, Sue Corey. She's awesome. You know, she really, I don't have to ask a lot of things, she just does. And now our outreach coordinator, Annette Fortier, is the same, you know, she's only been there 2 weeks. And the seniors just, you know, are just so loving and everything. You know, they accept you and they care about you. So.
And if there's a problem, the seniors tell us real quick.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, they do. All right. Any else? Thank you, Marlene.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Nice evening.
You too.
Okay. Next up. History lesson with the fire department. Nice. Did you need the finance committee here, or you just wanted to talk to us?
Anybody that wants to stay and listen, you're all welcome to.
So, Sean, if you guys want to stay, that's fine. It's not that.
Is this okay. About the old fire truck?
Huh? What's that, Bruce?
Is this about the old fire truck?
No.
No.
Oh. There are related material, but no, this is when I asked Harry if I could come in, at first it was just to give a brief history and about the fire department. And it's a very special day to me to maybe present a little bit of history. And with the 300th anniversary coming up, you know, I mentioned to Chief that, you know, it'd be nice to start getting more history of the fire department out to the general public. And when I started to look at the material, the history really started to become more of it. I mentioned to Chief Benjamin, more of a restoration of the history of the fire department, because there is a lot out there, well, not a lot out there, but there are some things that over the years we can't necessarily document. Through historical references, primary sources. So I asked the chief if I could do a presentation at the fire station tonight. And we just done with that. And, you know, what I had hope with that, a lot of the young people would come in. We have come out and worked out there, and a couple of young girls there.
About, as we speak, about 42 scouts.
Nice.
Having the run of the place, with the firefighters giving tours and...
You let them ring the bells. I'm sure that would alarm sirens.
For that reason, don't let them go nuts.
Yeah, I'd want to go there.
Gotta let them get that out.
Yeah. So if you guys want to stay, that's fine. But I think that's our last.
I'm really not going to take that long because I know that you know people have their own lives and everything. And, you know, I spent about 45 minutes doing my presentation. I want it to be short, and I have a PowerPoint presentation for people and. And it was kind of a special ending that was special for me. But you know, if you want to take a listen, fantastic.
What do you think, Jim? 10, 15 minutes?
No, probably not even that. If I can ask him to help me and answer one question first, okay? And I'll give you some documentation so that it will be really easy. You won't be put off.
Come on up, Jim.
All right?
Sure.
But you know, I did. Make some
Thanks
of the
so much.
Documentation that's out there, and you know, one of the questions that you know I wanted to ask you take about like 10 seconds at the moment, and look at the documentation, then I'll start from there. Okay. The question that I want to ask you is, when was the fire department started?
1934.
1934. Good answer. Okay. Now,
1934. It's highlighted on the highlight.
That means, and that's all printed.
That's brilliant.
You know, that information already written out. Some of it comes from the history of Sunderland. Some of it comes from newspaper articles. Some of it comes from, well, there's a number of different sources. And that means that, you know, there's 83 years of history. And what I told the people at the fire station is that I didn't want to go through 83 years of history for them and say, you know, this is what happened. So I broke it down into 8 groups. So far, you had 8 fire chiefs, and what I mentioned to them is that I knew 7 of them. The one that I didn't know was the first fire chief, Mr. Mills. And I did mention to them that the first fire department report appeared in the town report in 1934. And, you know, you said, well, you know, that document, you know, that when the fire department, you know, started. But if you notice on all of those documentations, you know, they're just highlighted. And the reason why they're highlighted is that there's nothing saying that it was ever formed in 1934. It's just all of a sudden here, you know, in print, 1934, and everybody accepted that. So as time went on, you know, different things in the fire department, you know, went on that started to make me question, you know, what was really authentic history of the fire department. So I started doing more and more research, and I think that you said it and say that I did a okay job.
Good job.
Thank you. And, you know, one of the reasons why I took it upon myself is that he appointed me as the officer of history in the fire department.
Nice.
And I thought, you know, I have my wand out, and
yeah.
Wow, you know, I'm like a wizard of history. And that was part of the thing. Yeah, I think, you know, people enjoyed that. But, you know, on a serious note, you know, 83 years of history and everything, you know, that we really can't document. You know, it's kind of troublesome because, you know, town officials have said that. Fire chiefs have said that, and you know, I've asked for people to document where they got the information, and they can't do it. Mm-hmm. So I have to give Wendy a lot of credit because she helped me out tremendously, even though she may not realize it. And I'll say it right now in front of all of you, she did. Because as I was getting some of the papers from her and kind of finding little bits of information here and there about, you know, the fire department, everything started to fall in place. And I went to Wendy out there. Wendy, I would like to see the minutes of the town meeting from this year to this year. And she got them for me. And I spent time reading them. And what I found was that the fire department didn't start in 1934. And I think, do you want to tell them more? Or do you want to
come on? Come on.
Yes,
I'll do this while you do that.
It's a very different day for me. Because not only am I the oldest fire, active fire department department today, but I am also the longest director. I started on 1971, officially, or that my name first appeared. And when I did my research.
1934?
There you go.
When I did my research, I found that the fire department actually started in 1933. And, you know, I looked at the research again with when you provided me, and it turns out that the fire department was formed at a town meeting on February 6th, 1933. So, in honor of today.
Cake for everybody.
It would be really nice if, you know, we hear it, and I said, that's the day for me that, you know, everybody would maybe enjoy a little piece of birthday cake.
Fire department's birthday.
You guys are smart to stay.
Yes.
You got a birthday cake.
The fire department is actually 84 years old today. And that next year, when it's 300, it'll be 85 years old. So, you know, it's kind of a restoration of fire department history. Restoration means bringing back to original state. And hopefully we can do more with maybe restoring the history of the fire department, because if you look at those documents, there's a lot of places that are marked in, in highlighted in yellow, and those are areas that, you know, maybe they're parts you like, and I've asked if, you know, people that wrote them or people that knew would document it, and I haven't gotten any of the documentation, so I'm thinking, you know, is it documental? And what, you know, what are they really saying? And like I said, some of them are, you know, leaders of the town and everything. So,
that's pretty sweet.
Just to, again, update everybody and have a brief moment of history. You know, happy birthday. you know, have the fire chief recognize that people are strong in some areas, but, you know, maybe not strong in other areas, and, you know, kind of just knowing first, you know, first couple of years, he starts to know his people really well.
Nice.
You know, I thank you for your attention.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Hey, Jim, while you're here, you want to give an update on the Rio?
I haven't heard any information on the Rio. I didn't find it yet.
So it is being worked on?
It's being worked on as of December, but we're supposed to, according to the application and everything, we're going to update that for it. I haven't received anything yet. I'm not in charge of it, so I have no idea. We haven't had any meetings.
Steve?
Bobby's had communications with the gentleman in Maine that's working on it. And at this point, the body's been taken off, and they're in the process of identifying all the unseen items that you couldn't necessarily identify just while it was intact.
Yep.
From what we've been told, it's a good, solid case. Not really anything unexpected has
good.
Been identified, but like anything else, it takes some time.
So what? You just stated a date for the Rio.
1925.
And I just saw something, the newspaper article that said it's a 23.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And as of 1922, it was registered with title as 1923, and that's the first time that we see a date on it when it was sold to Halifax, Vermont.
Mm-hmm.
There was no date on it. There was no sale when we bought it. There was no date as to what year. Actually, I found out through a book that is about Rio Howell Fire Truck, the Howell Fire Apparatus Truck, that they had different pictures. And looking at the numbers on the Rio and looking at one of the pictures had a number that was really close, but it said that it was a 19.5. And on our association Rio, the number of that truck was like maybe 50, number 50 below what the picture was. And so, it couldn't have been a 23 because it was so close to being a 26 or whatever that, you know, it had to be a 25. When I looked at more of the information, I found out that it was mentioned in a newspaper article that it came from Ridge, New Hampshire.
Yeah.
I called the fire department in Ridge, New Hampshire, and I asked if I could speak with the chief and one of his lieutenants or one of the four fire wardens said, well, no, and he's not here at the moment. He asked me what I was calling about on there. I think that we may have your original fire truck. And there, I think that we may have, it was a 1925. And he said, yeah. He said, we have a picture of it on our wall. And so he sent me the picture. And the picture is, do you people have a picture of it?
I don't remember seeing it, Jim, if we have one.
Then I will give you a picture of it because it documents what it looked like originally really well. And if it, you know, documents and, you know, what it looked like, then, you know, it's really a neat-looking truck and everything. Hopefully, the, you know, what you people have said is that, you know, yes, it should be restored to original. And hopefully it'll look a lot like that. But the fire chief right away said that, you know, if we had it, and I went up and I talked with him a couple of times, and he said, you know, we would like it back. Because they are also having, I think it's going to be 50 next year.
Hmm.
And they would like like to, you know, have it with their parade too. But, you know, it was, you know, their fire company to give it. They were trying to original history or, you know, authentic and
small fee.
Yeah. A rental fee.
Long process and everything, and, you know, they sold it. And technically, I have to say, you know, it came from Rinton, New Hampshire, but we may have bought it as a strict down truck. And, you know, depending on what you think is, you know, original, you know, if you're restoring to when Sunderland bought it, it would be restored to 1937. They wouldn't have that much money, that way on it, right? Most fire departments, when they sell a truck or town sell a truck, they take one equipment, they want it off.
Right.
And, you know, they
sell what's left.
You know, as a beer bone type bucket. You know, well, it would be a neat part of not only Rinton's history, but Sunderland's history, and also Halifax's history, and West Halifax's history.
Trump got around.
Yeah.
Well, the history is not necessarily Sunderland history. It probably should be more the truck history and how Sunderland gets into the
truck
history. Right. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's, you know, what I think was, you know, a restoration project would be, and not necessarily a preservation project.
That's smart.
Just my thoughts, but other people have their different opinions and thoughts and everything, and, you know, I'm only one person.
Thanks for sharing with us tonight, yeah. Jim.
Thank you.
It's great.
You.
Great.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Happy birthday.
Yeah. But it is, you know, nice that, you know, I had the opportunity to be in the only family of all the
servants
to tell people that information. That was important to me. People are
trying
to get worried about
fire
departments.
Thank you.
There you go.
That's right.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good
night.
All right. Minutes from 1:30:17. Thanks for staying, Sean.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks. Motion on the minutes of the 30th.
Okay. Motion made.
Second.
All those in favor of the minutes of 1:30:17 signify by saying aye.
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 Okay. We're set. Snow and ice deficiency. Looks like the highway soup looking for a little extra money.
So they're looking for $12,000 in materials and $7,000 in labor.
Motion.
Move the request of the highway superintendent deficit spending of raising the cap for spending of $12,000 in materials and is adding $7,000 in a wage appropriation.
Any further second?
Second.
Discussion?
Now, we've done this a couple of times. We kept our snow and ice level last year expenses. We ticked it up a couple of times in years prior, but $12,000 isn't bad considering we're in February.
Right. Halfway through.
Well, you know, it's funny. I just want just to remind people, I understand we don't have a lot of snow,
yeah.
But unfortunately we use a lot of material on the types of storms that we're getting right now, exactly. The ice and sleet and stuff. Yeah. So I understand. Yep. Sherry, we just need to keep an eye on this. Okay. Motion made and seconded to increase the material line item and the snow and ice wages. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Anything else? Okay, so next week is February 13th is our next meeting. Same place, same time. Entertain a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Sherry, let's declare us out at 8:52, please.